Any apologies?
Andy Holt and Andrew Cox.
Okay, anyone else? No? Okay, has anyone been objected to being filmed and only recorded?
No.
No? Okay, anyone got any interests? No? Any matter of the minutes?
Is that anything we got now?
Yeah. Okay, that's okay, very. Item three, Marcus.
Yes, Sammy Chair, the purpose of this report is for members to review and approve the licence fees in respect of premises licences required under the Gambling Act 2005 with effect from the 1st of April 2015. As members are aware, this committee is also responsible for the functions under the Gambling Act as well as the Licensing Act. And there are regulations made under the Gambling Act that say that the licensing authority may determine the fees for a premises licence up to a maximum level that is set out in the regulations. The levels of those fees are attached in Appendix 1. When we are setting fees, the legislation says that we should aim to ensure that the income from the fees are as nearly as possible equating to the cost of providing the service to which that fee relates. In 2007, when the legislation came into effect, the fees were set at 20% below the maximum fee. And these fees are the fees that are currently charged, and they're set out in Appendix 2. There is a requirement that as a licensing authority, we should publish the fees and determine them from time to time. It's not set exactly how frequently that is. As you can see, that wording is from time to time. What I have done is carry out a review of the cost with our finance section, the cost of providing services under the Gambling Act. And having carried out that exercise, it is showing a small projected excess of income over expenditure of some £908.22 for the current financial year. Some members may be aware that officers within the council, obviously including licensing officers, were awarded 2.2% increase in pay, which became effective in January this year. So therefore, what I do know is that over the next financial year, we will have a 2.2% increase in our costs. So what I'm suggesting is that where it's showing in excess, that excess will be taken up over the next financial year through the 2.2% increase in staffing costs. There may be other costs, but they are the costs that I know will occur. And therefore, I am seeking approval that the fees that we currently charge remain the same and become effective again from the 1st of April this year.
Okay. Thanks, Marcus. Any?
Just one question in relation to those two particular. On 2.6 and 2.7, we've got the increase of 2.2%. Will the 900 surplus be sufficient to cover that for the rest of the financial year? I don't think we've taken balance either way.
It works out incredibly around about £890 it was incredibly close to that £908.
Thanks, just a clarification really, the difference in fees between fast track application and non-fast track.
If I can assist those fees are no longer, that they were under the transitional provisions, so they're no longer. Obviously, the fees had to be set to deal with applications where we had transfers during when the legislation came into effect.
Okay.
Can I ask?
Yes,
certainly.
And you can't get a load of houses if you want to allow it or sort of what's that what they do.
I have certainly spoken with other authorities and they do vary. Some charge up to the maximum, some charge sort of under 20, they go less than our own fees. What's important is that the fees are set in accordance with our costs. We have to justify them. So they will vary from each authority depending upon the number of staff that are employed and obviously the gradings that the staff in those authorities work to. So there will be a difference in cost. And it's quite a national debate really about the setting of fees. And just for information, there was live consultation from last year, in fact probably started the year before, with regard to fees under the Licensing Act 2003, which are currently set based on the rateable value of a property. And there were representations made some time ago that local authorities should be given the ability to set their own fees. The results of those that consultation has been that there was such a variation in terms of the feedback that came back. And also there was no real standard, if you like, fees from that came back from some authorities. Not all authorities gave details of what their fees or what their costings were. That the government have decided to leave it as it is and therefore leave it based on the rateable value. Because there can be such a variance, whereas that seems to be more of a stable balance for people. Because there are
a second one.
Yeah.
That's fine. You said the 2.2 increase in salaries. Salaries is not the only cost. What proportion of your costs are salaries?
I wouldn't want to guess it at the moment because I'd say it was worked out. But you are quite right that is only one part of our costs. We obviously have recharges on our costs from the other services that are provided. We also have costs through our IT, etc. So I am acknowledging that in the report that they are the only known costs. What we can do is obviously if we review the costs next year and we show a deficit, then we would look to increase the costs thereafter. So the fees have to be based on where we're at now rather than where, if we had no increases in various other costs, then I'd do that. But the costs were not just based on staffing costs, the 980 were not just on staffing. But I wouldn't want to just guess that those figures are positive.
Yes, just to thank our officers of the board and to formally move that we accept the recommendation.
Agreed.
Thank you. Who's second of that?
Me. Sorry, yes? Chair, I didn't put my hand up, but it's my apologies. Item 4.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report reaffirms that
local
really is to just give some information to members, and it really just asks if people know the report or have got any questions. Members of this committee know how busy they are in terms of attending hearings and dealing with matters through applications and license reviews. But it's really just to set out and give members some indication of the applications that are coming through licensing. And obviously I know members are also interested in those premises that surrender or allow their licenses to lapse. And So I have provided details of that in Appendix 2. So people who were premises used to have a license no longer have those licenses. And there have been a total of 30 premises that have surrendered their licenses in the last, from 1st of April last year to the 5th of March. Obviously, that did include, we did have a number of licenses granted for the Open Championship. You can see there's a considerable amount of temporary led notices that are dealt with during the years, just under 500. Temporary event notices, that's a very widely used process. There are other processes that have not been included in the report in terms of changes of designated premises supervisors and transfers, etc. There's a lot of that, but those are just some of the key activities that have taken place.
Okay, thank you. I've got two questions. I just wrote this under. The Central Hotel. It's closed anyway now, and that's up for sale. But what I did notice here, and probably I may have the answer myself, the Cotton Club in Algan Street is still open. Halfway down.
Right, yeah, what that will be is that somebody else will have taken it over. Anyone
else?
Yeah.
Three of the members of this committee spent 3 hours this afternoon doing one application. So the issue with regard to the committee, whilst I welcome it, it doesn't really talk about officer time or members' time in dealing with what would appear to be a small number, but very lengthy applications for reviews, etc. I do welcome the report, and I think it's very useful, particularly the appendices. And I congratulate Margaret and all her staff on the work they've done over the past year.
Could I just formally thank members for their support then over the last year and for their willingness and ability to attend our hearings, which is sometimes at short notice. So I do thank you for that. It's just recognising that obviously we do have statutory timescales to keep to, and I think it is a credit to all members that they do assist us in meeting those targets and timescales. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Chair. It's just one which was brought up this afternoon, and actually I brought up, is where we get people applying for a lot premises licenses here, is it not possible for us to record where the verses come from? I know it's an additional heartache, we say, whether it can be done or not, I don't know, because we came up along this afternoon where the person couldn't even remember where he'd done his license from. I mean, this is absolutely horrendous. If you sat here this afternoon, it was nearly 20 minutes before you could even talk about
it. And he only got his license 2 years ago. He grants his license, John.
So we're on record there. I'm sorry.
So we can't. John can't say anymore.
I can't say anymore. Because we're on record. Yeah. I don't want to. All I want to say is I want to highlight
the amount of work that goes into each individual case.
And the other thing is to say as well, the workbooks that do close don't know to ask until the license department.
Yeah, and also support what Steve said about Margaret and the license department. Yes. The hard work they put in. And also, let's not forget, is our committee officers. She does an excellent job. And also our solicitors do
packages
occasionally.
I don't agree.
It's only the clerk that does anything. Can I just ask, how did the number of licenses applicable compare to previous years? Has it been more drugs and or does it still fluctuate this year? Yeah, I haven't got that. What we'll do now is we'll keep an eye on that for you. We'll bring the regular reports to you. I can do that, but I haven't got figures for you now. I think on balance it does, you know, anecdotally it does tend to be about the same. Although I think what one does vary as well is license reviews in terms of the way of the subcommittee. We did go through a phase where we were having regular reviews of license premises, and it depends upon the activity of the other responsible authorities. That's outside of our own work. So depending on particular activity by Merseyside Police or by trading standards, that will bring in possible review applications. So when I know the police were focused on a particular area, we were having very regular reviews. At one point we were having more than most other authorities in the country. I think that's where things change as we go forward, but I think it's usually about the same. So it's interesting for me the balance between those that have surrendered or allowed their license. When it's been lapsed, when it talks about and picking up on the cotton club, what happened there was it was because the company had been dissolved and there is an opportunity within 28 days for somebody else to like to resurrect that license, and that's what happened.
Did you hear how the public house is struggling, how these keep going? It'd just be interesting to know the trend
The national average now, the latest figures is 31.2%.
And I would also like to offer my congratulations to all the staff involved in all this. Extremely well done. No.
Okay, just a quickie here. Perhaps to follow on what Councillor Williams has said, if we the next update report had a table so we can track the applications, the reviews and all the rest of it over the years, just as a table within the report.
Beautiful.
Anyone else? Yeah, while we're looking at all this update, and we'd like to refer to item 3.3, the temporary event notices, obviously nearly 500. What frustrates us very much in our area, I'm sure in yours as well, is that quite a lot of the temporary events applications are approved to give people to let them over outside the planning house. Now, surely we could not grant temporary event licenses if we knew that there were some very easy for you to check to see if it was within the planning area. So what grieves me, and I'd like to know what other members think, is surely if somebody has got a license to get out of his living in the open house, then they shouldn't be having a temporary event which outside those houses. Or if they are going to, they should be applying for a civil planning permission for them. So why shouldn't we just do that?
Yeah.
Well,
if I can answer, the temporary events process is completely different from licenses that we grant. We don't actually grant temporary event notices. We acknowledge that notice. It is what it says on the tin, it's a notice. It's them notifying the licensing authority that they are going to operate in this particular way for this particular event. What they also have to do is to serve that notification on Merseyside Police and Environmental Health. They are the only two bodies who can object to a temporary event notice.
Who says?
The law.
The
licensing
act.
We do notify planning of those notices, and it is a matter for planning to take action and to be in contact with those premises, because they will know from our information that we supply to them that we have a temporary event notice, and it really is for them to check whether or not those premises have the appropriate planning permission.
Can't we then lobby for a change in the law? Because it's quite ridiculous that people are able to trade to have outside the green planning house. I mean, it's ridiculous. Yes. And you say, well, you're only acknowledging it. You're not involved in it at all, they say.
is a representation from environmental health or the police, then it will go to a hearing. And so we obviously have to facilitate that hearing. We don't make the decision on it, it would then be for the subcommittee to make the decision. It can be the case also that a premises licence is granted outside of planning as well, and I know that causes frustration. We have got it written into our licensing policy now that we do expect people, before they apply for a premises licence, and indeed temporary, you know, to have the appropriate planning permission. But what the guidance says is that they are still two separate processes and should be dealt with as two separate processes, but that we should communicate better with each other, which is what we do. And as I say, we would let planning know if a premises were seeking to operate outside, and any application that comes in for a premises license or to vary their license must be served on planning, and they have an opportunity to object to that. So that's the process that they do have.
Wait, just on there. So you, did I hear right then that when a temporary event service is requested, it can't be a bit automatic because planning, or that it must be notified planning as well?
We don't have to, but we do.
Planning would say they don't. Planning say they don't know about the events.
Well, we tell them that.
They do.
We tell them
that. Because we've checked. I don't think I'm assuming about that area, was it? I'm not talking about the golf pit, I'm talking about general. Locals are horrified sometimes to find there's a temporary event which is miles outside the planning requirements. When they've asked planning for planning, they say, well, it's nothing to do with us. It's a licensing matter.
Well, what they say is that, yes, they can't object to it, but they can take action if they know.
What action is there apart from objecting them?
Well, because they're enforcement actions, because they're operating outside of their planning. And they are very familiar with
it.
Point to that, receive notification well in advance of any reasons taking place. As individual councillors, I think it's up to us then to contact the planning departments and say, we don't agree with this particular law. What are you doing there?
And we all went to Casbridge on one hand, we all went to the other.
So we all be saying it.
Is it mostly out of line? Is it mostly out of line? Sorry, Chair.
Selling alcohol, we're all about our trees. So over the next 2 days, we're going to have four meetings, one at 9:30 and one at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I think I've got policy tomorrow. We'll start this Friday afternoon, then Birkenhead must be Friday morning, and Willow West probably tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry. I do apologise, it's been very busy, and
thank you.
But we've got considerable amounts of people attending. I've got less people attending from Willow West than yourself, so I'm going to look at that and try and find out why that is. The other two constituencies seem to be fairly well represented. But again, our feedback on that.
Okay.
What
time is that morning?
The morning session starts at 9:30 and the afternoon session starts at 2:30.
Good morning, Board Chair.
Okay.
Thank you.
Can I just, before we end the meeting, can I just thank Smith, Lawrence, where you are.
Yes.
I don't get my manager the opportunity now, I'm not sure if many people and my client.
You said that because of course I'm saying
it's good luck to you all. Okay, then,
yes,
thank you, everybody, for the attendance.
Yes, Chair.